वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, रेस्पेक्टेड डिग्नेटरीज, प्रोफेसर प्रदीप कुमार सिन्हा, डायरेक्टर IIIT नया रायपुर, चीफ गेस्ट प्रोफेसर गीतम सिंह तोमर, चेयरमैन IIIE एमपी सेक्शन, गेस्ट डॉक्टर DK मिश्रा, एक्स चेयरमैन IIIE एमपी सेक्शन, करंट नेशनल ट्रेजरर CSI इंडिया, डॉक्टर राजश्री महापात्र, डीन एकेडमिक्स, डॉक्टर पुण्य पी पलटानी, डीन R&D, फैकल्टी मेंबर्स, पार्टिसिपेंट्स, ऑथर्स, रिसर्चर्स हु हैव कंट्रीब्यूटेड देयर रिसर्च पेपर एंड IIIT एनआरियंस। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ IIIT एनआर फ्रैटर्निटी, आई प्रियंका गुप्ता वुड लाइक टू वेलकम यू ऑल टू द इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑन टेक्नोलॉजी रिसर्च एंड इनोवेशन फॉर बेटरमेंट ऑफ सोसाइटी ट्राइब्स 2021, ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय IIIT नया रायपुर। Before embarking on this journey, first we will have our auspicious lamp lighting ceremony by our respected dignitaries. I request our Director Sir, Dean Research and Development, Dean Academics, and Conference Coordinator to lamp the light.
हे शारदे माँ, अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ। हे शारदे माँ, अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ। तू स्वर की देवी है, संगीत तुझसे, हर शब्द तेरा है, हर गीत तुझसे। तू स्वर की देवी है, संगीत तुझसे, हर शब्द तेरा है, हर गीत तुझसे। हम हैं अकेले, हम हैं अधूरे, तेरे शरण में हमें तार दे माँ। हे शारदे माँ, अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ। हे शारदे माँ, अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ।
Moving on, now we will be releasing the soft copy of the conference brochure, followed by the release of conference video. May I request our Director Sir, Professor Pradeep Kumar Sinha, to do the honors.
Click on that drop down. Click on that drop down. Run this drop down.
Thank you.
Now I request Dr. Pradeep Kumar Sinha, Director IIIT NR, to deliver his welcome address on this occasion. Before inviting him onto the dais for his welcome address, I would like to enlighten us with his brief bio. Dr. Pradeep Kumar Sinha is the founding vice chancellor and director of International Institute of Information Technology, Naya Raipur. Earlier, he was with the Center for Development of Advanced Computing, where he had led national programs in areas of supercomputing, deep computing, and health informatics. Prior to joining CDAC, Dr. Sinha was in Japan for 10 years, working on cutting-edge computing technologies. Dr. Sinha is an educationist, researcher, scientist, inventor, and internationally acclaimed author of computer textbooks with more than 35 years of professional experience. Dr. Sinha is a fellow of IEEE, fellow of Computer Society of India, and ACM Distinguished Engineer. He is also the recipient of several other awards and recognitions. Since 2015, Dr. Sinha has been deeply involved in building IIIT Naya Raipur as a premier academic institute of the country. He is also on the governing board of several technical institutes like IIT Bhilai, NIT Raipur, डी वाई पाटिल कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग पुणे, जागरण लेक सिटी यूनिवर्सिटी भोपाल।
सर आज
करके हाँ कर
सर एक्चुअली यहाँ पे पता नहीं होता
सामने हो
सर, आप साइन कर दीजिए फिर करा के सबमिट करो।
हाँ कर
एक्चुअली आज लैब है हमारे।
हाँ करा लूँ
साइन कर दीजिए तो मैं 20 सर सबमिट करना है इसको या अपने खाते ले जाना 27
कैडी चेक के लिए।
ओके सर, मैं स्पाइरल घर से करा लूंगी, आप साइन कर दीजिए।
Thank you and very good morning to everyone present for this curtain raiser session, present physically as well as online. It's a great day for us. First of all, I'd like to welcome our chief guest, Professor G.S. Tomar, the chairman of IEEE MP subsection, Dr. Durgesh Mishra, Professor Yagna Narayana. I also see he is present online. He is my guru from my days of IIT Madras. And there are many others, eminent dignitaries present today online, because the convocation actually, this conference is being held in hybrid mode. I also see all my faculty members present here who have been really, really working hard to actually conceptualize this conference. The research scholars, the M.Tech students, B.Tech students, our staff members who have been working really hard with the faculty members for this day for which we have assembled. The first version of the first day of the first version of this 3 days technical enlightening intervention conceived and being executed by IIIT near Rackpur with the help of IEEE, especially IEEE MP section. We have also taken help from other IEEE members of other IEEE sections. Like we also discussed with IIT Bombay and others for guidance. So in fact, it was a great effort, combined effort. There are many international keynote speakers, many participants, many authored papers, reviewed authored papers, who have all actually submitted their research work for this conference. On behalf of IIIT near Rackpur, I welcome you all to this 3 days international conference named Tribes. I will just like to give a genesis of this conference, how we actually conceived the idea of the conference and how it came into being and for which we have assembled here for the next 3 days for this technical interaction with the entire international community. As you all are aware, IIIT near Rackpur is basically a relatively new premier academic institute of the country. We started our operations in the year 2015 with the first batch of BTech students. And today we started only with a BTech program. Today we have three disciplines, three branches of Bachelor of Technology: Computer Science and Engineering, Electronics and Communication Engineering, and we also introduced a futuristic branch, Data Science and Artificial Intelligence, a few years later. We immediately realized that a premier academic institution like IIIT Raipur, the two basic pillars of such an institute to become a premier institute is both education and research. Having embarked upon with the educational programs, we quickly actually decided that we should strengthen our research arm. And with that, first of all, we started our PhD and MTech programs. They are all multidisciplinary. We also started actually looking for other avenues and perspectives to strengthen our research programs in addition to actually doing submitting project proposals. One thing that we decided was we should identify our research focus, understanding the locus operandi of our own institute. And while we were preparing our vision document for this academic institute, we decided that we have to take advantage of our geographical location in Chhattisgarh, the resources available in Chhattisgarh, and then think globally and act locally should be our motto. So whatever we actually decide to work on for a global perspective, there should be experimentation or areas to actually test what we are doing. And with that, we decided that our research focus will be to convert IIIT NR, Naya Raipur, we call it IIIT NR in short, into a living research lab for agriculture, forestry, and rural development. So, with that focus, we started all our research activities and programs to convert IIIT NR into a living research lab for agriculture, forestry, and rural development. That was based on what are the resource strengths of Chhattisgarh, where is Chhattisgarh rich, so that we'll have case studies to work with. And one of the things in rural development came is Chhattisgarh is also rich in tribal community. And there has to be a lot of research to be done for the upliftment of the tribal community as part of our rural development initiatives. And that's how our faculty members coined a very nice name for this conference: Tribes. It matches with our R&D vision. Okay, and it's a very good acronym for Technology Research and Innovation for Betterment of Society. We also started working on various other outreach programs. One of it was immediately starting an IEEE student branch, where our IEEE MP subsection was very, very helpful. Okay. And today we have a vibrant IEEE student branch in IIIT near Raipur, being steered by the research scholars and the students. And this conference actually was an outcome of our discussions of how to actually strengthen our research pillar. The faculty members immediately proposed that, sir, the institute should have its own conference. And I always welcome such ideas. I told, yes, let us go ahead, but be careful. Organizing and executing a conference is a difficult task and requires year-long effort. All the faculty members being very enthusiastic here, they told, sir, don't worry, we'll take care of that. Okay. We will work hard to see that. I was slightly skeptical whether we'll be able to do it in 1 year time or not. When the idea actually came and we started discussing about it, then of course we steered it through our Senate, our board, and got approvals for conducting this conference, and we floated the call for papers with that approvals taken. Also, we took actually help of IEEE MP subsection to join and support us. And fortunately, we got enormous support from the MP subsection, and that's why today we are calling it an IEEE conference. Okay. Because we got the permission to use the IEEE logo, use the IEEE name, and also to actually publish the presented papers in the IEEE Explore. So thank you to the IEEE MP subsection for supporting this. And the once the IEEE brand was associated with the conference, I was also skeptical what will be the interest from the presenters or from the researchers to submit papers here, because this being a totally new conference, the interest may not be that much. But I was surprised when we were reviewing the submissions, okay, that more than 200 papers, odd papers were there, and we had tough time in actually narrowing down on which papers to be selected for presentation. We also actually, we are fortunate that renowned technologists and academicians from across the world came forward to be part of this event, and that also actually gave a lot of strength to us, as well as made the conference look a really, really place to be associated with. Many of these dignitaries and world-class academicians and researchers will be giving keynote addresses during the 3 days intervention, and I'm sure that with their presence, the audience will be really, really, audience will find it enriching to be associated with this conference. So I'm sure that our objective of actually starting a technical conference to actually bring researchers, academicians, industry people together to deliberate on how information technology and associated disciplines can be used for the betterment of society. Will really take shape, and I'm sure that with the experiences that we will gain over these 3 days, we'll be able to come out with a far, far, far better version next year. So with these few words, I once again thank our chief guest for support from IEEE MP section, Professor G.S. Tomar, who is the chairman of IEEE MP section, Dr. Durgesh Mishraji, other actually keynote speakers of the various sessions and tracks, and of course, all the researchers who submitted their research work to make the conference a really technically and socially relevant. I once again welcome everyone present with us for these 3 days, and thank everyone on behalf of my institute for their support in making our vision of starting a conference in Central India on this theme, go ahead with hopes of success. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Dr. Manoj Kumar Majumdar, Assistant Professor, Department of ECE, and the organizing chair of this event, to give the briefing of the conference. Before inviting him onto the dais for his conference briefing, I would like to apprise you all with his brief bio. Dr. Manoj Kumar Majumdar is an assistant professor in electronics and communication engineering discipline. Prior to joining IIITNR, Dr. Majumdar was an assistant professor and teacher in charge in Techno India University, West Bengal. He has been awarded his PhD from Microelectronics and VLSI Group, Electronics and Communication Engineering Department, IIT Roorkee. He has authored more than 30 papers in peer-reviewed international journals and more than 50 papers in international conferences, and has co-authored 3 books. He is also an active reviewer of IEEE journals and other Springer journals. His name has been listed in Marquis Who's Who in the World. He is a senior member of IEEE and IEEE Circuits and System Society. So please.
Thank you. And good morning to all of you. Good morning to our respected director, sir, Dean Academic, sir, Dean Arendi sir, my faculty colleagues, students, PhD and MTech, and also the BTech students, all the participants, and the authors, and the keynote speakers. So on behalf of the organizing committee, with great personal pleasure, I welcome you to the International Conference of Technology, Research and Innovation for Betterment of Society, TRIPES 2021. The history of all hitherto existing human society is the history of scientific inventions. Starting from the invention of fire, each scientific innovation changes the whole human civilization forever. Technology for us is the application of scientific knowledge for practical purposes, especially in industry. Scientific knowledge is being shared from one to another regardless the race of race, ethnicity, cultural identity, or national boundary through conferences, journals, or books, and it becomes the property of the whole human civilization. Here, the conference, International Conference on Technology, Research, and Innovation for Betterment of Society, TRIPES 2021, has been initiated to share and preserve the scientific observations and conclusions in all aspects of science and technology, including the social sciences. The primary focus of the conference is on the modern applications related to electronics and IT for the uplift of the society. The key aim of the conference is to put all globally renowned scholars, educators, and industry workers under one roof. Due to the COVID-19 pandemic restrictions, the conference is organized in hybrid mode through Cisco WebEx. It has been inaugurated today, that is December 17, 2021, and it will be continuing up to December 19, 2021, Sunday. At the early stage of the conference, 201 manuscripts of various fields, especially in VLSI and robotics, communication, signal processing, artificial intelligence, data science, cyber security, applied mathematics from the multiple nations, including India, Sri Lanka, China, Japan, and Bangladesh, etc., were received through the Microsoft CMT. Each manuscript has been reviewed by more than 2 reviewers of the respective fields. More than 90 experts of the respective fields reviewed the manuscripts. Out of the 201 manuscripts, only 67 manuscripts were recommended to present in the conference. The acceptance ratio is approximately 33.3%. As the conference is in hybrid mode, so there is not a poster presentation. All presentations are divided into 18 different sessions under 54 session chairs. All the esteemed faculty and staff members, PhD scholars and technical assistants will coordinate the whole presentation through the 3 parallel channels of Cisco WebEx. There are 8 keynote sessions. 2 will be on today, that is December 17. 3 will be on tomorrow, December 18. And the other 3 will be on December 19, 2021. I want to thank all the keynote speakers for their valuable time at this conference. 2 types of awards will be also presented at the end of the conference, namely the Best Paper Award and Young Researcher Award. 1 Best Paper Award will be given to the participants of each track based on the evaluation marks that provided by the respective session chairs. The Young Researcher Award will be presented to the PhD candidates. They are studying in India or abroad. The candidate will be selected based on their resume, research publications, PhD research plan, and the quality of paper accepted in TRIPES 2021. I want to thank all the reviewers, coordinators, and session chairs for their valuable time for this conference. I would also like to thank all the authors for their choice to present their work on this platform. It is in hybrid mode. If any mistake comes to our to your observation, please let us know. Your corrections, suggestions, advice, and guidance will help us to improve the conference in the coming years. I sincerely hope that you will enjoy the technical program about to unfold in the next 3 days, and that you will leave the conference with fond memories of TRIBES 2021 through the scientific exchanges you engaged in while you attended. Thank you so much. And once again, I welcome all of you to the TRIBES 2021. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed our great pleasure to have with us today Dr. Geetam Singh Tomar, Chairman, IEEE MP Subsection. Dr. Geetam Singh Tomar could not join us physically, but he is with us virtually. Before inviting him for his address, let me enlighten you all with his brief bio. Dr. Geetam Singh Tomar received his UG, PG and PhD degrees in Electronics Engineering from Institution of Engineers, Calcutta, MNREC, Allahabad and RGPV, Bhopal respectively. He also received a second PhD in Computer Engineering from University of Bristol, UK and postdoc from University of Kent, UK. He worked with MITS and IIITM Gwalior, University of Kent, UK, University of West Indies, Trinidad and Tobago. He also served as director in 3 private colleges, along with additional charge of the director of Machine Intelligence Research Labs, Gwalior, India. He served in the Indian Air Force for 17 years before joining academics in 2001. His research interests are cognitive radio networks, digital system design, wireless sensor networks, future computing. He has sponsored 5 research projects to his credit. He has been a guest faculty at Thapar University, Patiala, Hanam University, Korea, and many other universities of international repute. He received the International Plato Award for Academic Intelligence Excellence in 2009 from IBC Cambridge, UK. He has been cited in Who's Who in the World for 2008, 2009, and 2010 continuously. He has published more than 230 research papers and 8 patents. He is the chief editor of more than 5 international journals and has written 12 books and 10 book chapters. He has organized more than 50 IEEE conferences in 7 different countries. He is a IEEE senior member, fellow IETE and IE member, ACM USA, CSI and IST. Please, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor P.K. Sinha, the only IEEE fellow of our section. So really, we are proud to have you as one of the lone IEEE fellow in our section. Professor Narayan, Professor Majumdar, deans, all HODs, delegates, young researchers, and available online, offline. Dr. Drugesh is also seen, so I owe my respect to him. It's really proud moment to have first TRIBES 2021 at your esteemed institute. Such conferences, it's not only for academic purpose, in fact, it is for basically to showcase our work, whatever current work we have. When we publish our papers, it may take time, but whatever you have or you have conceived ideas, immediately you need to showcase it to the world. So that role is being played by IEEE Raipur by organizing wonderful conference. It was I think having less time, that's why only 200 papers were there. Why I call it only 200, though it's a great number, because the person who is heading this institute is world renowned. And had it been more time, this conference would have had more than 500 papers. And one thing, one observation, we need to, for next series of conference, we need to curtail it to 25%, because sir is knowing that there are many universities in the world, if you have your series less than 25%, they allow their researcher to submit the papers. Otherwise, they do not allow them to submit to the conferences which have more than 25% of acceptance ratio. Being renowned institute, we need to restrict to 25% in our next series. As you know, now we have our own section, and hopefully what I plan that Chhattisgarh becomes subsection in next 1 year or 2 year with the support of Professor Sinha, because he can take this lead. Only you need to just propose for subsection with 20 members, which you already have. So then you have independent entity at Chhattisgarh under MP section. So you will have more, though there won't be any problem from section side, because it's a new section this year only. And this section, you consider it as Chhattisgarh section rather than entire MP section for your cause. So whatever help you need, whichever type of help you need, we all are with you and you are with us. That's what our concept is. Coming to the theme of conference, it's really wonderful, because finally whatever we have is for society. And we, if we are able to help society in any way, then our coming to this nature is justified. Otherwise, taking birth and going from this earth without having your stamp in your history is of no use. And you know it very well that we technocrats or teachers are the only person can have our stamp even without becoming any leader or anything. Because whatever we publish is available to the world. And whatever we publish is on the basis of society's need. Whether it's implemented or not, it's different matter. But whatever we conceive of our idea, it is always with some need of society. So in this way, we are the only person to inject the entire thing to GDP of any country. Because you may be knowing that whatever GDP you count, it's through industry or through society, whatever, even farmers are our partner in that case for improving or contribution to the GDP. So we should be proud of to be associated with academics and research, because we are responsible for everything. So we should not think subordinate to anyone. That is what my concept is. We are not subordinate to any service or anybody in this world. We are giving everything to society, but how can we give? First, we need to know the nature. Then we need to know the need of society and then work towards that. Fortunately, you are in the area where tribes are there. And you know it very well that whatever medicines or medicine plants which are available around you, after some time, no one will know what was there and how it was used. So it's my request or urge that you have to destroy this knowledge of tribes and make one center of excellence in your institute, which is related to only the destruction of tribal knowledge related to various plants, trees, or whatever medicated things are there, because they are self-reliant. They do not need anything if and they are satisfied with their jungles only. How? Because everything is available in our forest. So we need to have one center of excellence. And where you will find that even agriculture, whatever it is, it's part of that only. So soil testing, then the plant disease testing using sensor network. Nowadays, the sensor network is based for IoT. So in that case, your institute will be better than even other IITs also, because IITs are now producing the students for other nations, and we are producing the technocrats for our nation. So we are better than them, because finally our students are serving our nation. So we need to provide them each and everything. How? It's not locally. First of all, you have to have the global vision, and that is conferences are part of that. So in that case, your tribe conference, I am sure that next year you will have more and more such papers which are purely for the knowledge base of tribal issues and then social issues. And there are few tracks of IEEE which are separately publishing those papers. And next year, it is not only that technical support, we will be able to give you financial support also, because being section, we will have some funds also. So don't have to worry about that. We will manage funds. If you are really able to have this grant movement for having 400, 500 presentations, so for financially, you don't have to think of. So it's really wonderful to be associated with this conference, and services of every technocrat will be available to any conference of MP section from all other sections also. Thank you very much for calling me a chief guest, and I really owe your cooperation for future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable remarks. May I now request Dr. Pradeep Kumar Sinha, Director at IIITNR, to felicitate our chief guest, Dr. Geetam Singh Tomar. Since he is with us through virtual mode, I would request Dr. Punya P. Paltani, Dean Research and Development, IIITNR, to receive the memento on his behalf.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
We will be sending you this by post, sir.
No, I will come sometime, then I'll collect. You know, to send by post. Certainly, I'll come.
Okay, sir. You're always welcome, sir. Now I request Dr. Punya P. Paltani, Dean, Research and Development, to present a token of memento to our director, sir, P.K. Sinha. Now, I would like to call Dr. Vivek Tiwari, IIITNR, one of the coordinator of the conference, to say a few words. So, please.
Thank you. Honorable Vice Chancellor Director, Dr. P.K. Sinha of IIITNR Raipur, Chief Guest, Dr. Geetam Singh Tomar, Chairman IEEE MP section, Chairman IETE Gwalior section also. Our guest, Dr. Durgesh Kumar Mishra, ex IEEE Chairman MP subsection, Dean Academic Dr. Mahapatra, Dean R&D Dr. Paltani of IIT Raipur, my dear faculty members, other participants who have submitted their paper throughout the India. I welcome you all again in this 3 days national international conference TRIPES. I just came here to convey the thanks on behalf of the IIIT Raipur to a couple of persons who have really contributed a lot in this conference. I will start with the DK Mishra sir, because I think 1.5 years back when we had a meeting to have a conference in IIIT Raipur, since I had experience with organizing conference with the publisher Springer, so we thought about, as we have a IEEE chapter, it is this institute also, why should not go with the IEEE conference. So first person who I have contacted was the DK Mishra sir. I had a 10-year association with him. He had guided me a lot. Then I approached to the current secretary IEEE MP section, Dr. Jitendra Agarwal. He is associate professor in UIT Bhopal. He and one of the more important person, I must say, Dr. Manish Dixit, faculty in MITS Gwalior, currently vice chairman MP section. They helped me a lot because I had initially hesitation to contact to direct to the Tomar sir, because I had no any direct communication earlier with him, because he's a so known person in all over the India in that field. But I thought it is not right way to direct to contact to him. So through those persons, they have communicated the message to the Tomar sir. But I must say, whenever I first time talked to the Tomar sir, he was so kind, so friendly, so helping. I never think about that. He's a so senior, and whenever I feel I'm in trouble, I need to take the suggestions, I directly called him, messaged him, mailed him, immediately he has replied. So the way he had helped me a lot. So thank you, sir. Really, I really, we behalf of the IIIT Raipur, I want to convey our thanks to you. And Durgesh Mishra sir, I must say something about him. He is the current chairman ACM Indore chapter. He was the ex IEEE chairman Bombay section, and currently he is holding the national treasurer CSI India. He was ex chairman CSI division 4 India. So he has helped me a lot in this conference. So if sir you are there, am I audible? So please, if possible, to say something about and bless us with your kind words, if you are there. DK Mishra sir.
Yeah, I am here. I am here. Thank you. Thank you, Vivek. Are you able to listen to me?
Yes.
Am I audible?
Clear and loud. You are audible, sir.
Right. Because I am in the audio mode only. Right. Thank you. Thank you, Vijay, Dr. Vivek Tiwari, for inviting me to say a few words. And first of all, thanks to the Director, Vice Chancellor of IIIT and the Chairman Tomar sir, IEEE section. And he has done a very good effort to make a subsection to section. We have a lot of big journey towards this. And in his leadership, we will go further and will enhance the activities of the IEEE. And I think this is the first conference we are organizing under the IEEE section, MP section. This is the first conference in the Raipur. It's a very good effort by the Dr. Vivek Tiwari. You know, this conference is not a job of one day or 2 days. Is in the last, during this lockdown, he connected me and to organize this event. We had to organize some conference, and we thought about that, why not in the IEEE, because we are going to the section and all these things. So this is a very good efforts done by Dr. Vivek Tiwari, and Vivek Tiwari is very, very nice, and he has done a lot of work. His team is very good, his seniors are very good there, and they are cooperative and all these things. So, and received around 200 papers, as Dr. Tomar told, that in the next year possibly we will get a more paper, and then good, and we will have some funding also will provide from the IEEE MP sections. So thank you, Dr. Tomar, for this type of supports to the conference organizer. So I think this is a good, and best of luck for all the participants or the researchers, those who are submitting their papers and those got the positive review from the experts, and someone has not got the positive review, even that some negative reviews are there, they received, but that are also very important for the research so that they can enhance their paper and then submit in the other way. So this is a very good platform where we can do the good research. And because this is a pandemic, this is online, and this is in a blended mode, this is online offline. So I think in the next year we will do a complete offline, I think so. And so best of luck to Dr. Vivek Tiwari for the next 3 days. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Last but not the least, it's worth to mention that it is not IEEE normal conference. With the help of Tomar sir, they have declared and designated this conference as a flagship conference. What is the difference for the PhD student and the MTech student? I must say the difference between normal IEEE conference and the flagship conference is that IEEE charge something. So whenever you apply for any conference for the IEEE, there is some agreement and you have to pay 1.6 lakh rupees something to the IEEE before going to the conference. Other than that, every paper they charge $22, it comes around 1600 rupees per dollar, per paper they charge it. So we are so lucky, and with a special request, Dr. Tomar have considered our request and make our conference a flagship conference. Because of that, we didn't pay 1.6 lakh rupees to the IEEE. Plus, we are not need to give $22 per paper like that. So that is really great support, because being the first the conference we are organizing, it is very rarely so seen the first conference as a flagship conference. So Tomar sir, really we are so grateful to you for this kind of special support you have given us. You have shown us this trust and faith to us. And definitely in the future, we will be needing your support in all over the directions. And with these words, thank you a lot. And next time we will see you physically in here. This time I tried to call you Mr. Sir in the physical mode, but because of some issue reasons, you couldn't be here with us. So next time we'll be together to have us any occasions or next conference may be possible. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vivek sir. Now I request Dr. Rajasee Mahapatra, Dean Academics, IIITNR, to propose the vote of thanks.
Good morning, very good morning to all of you. It's my honor to propose a vote of thanks of this first conference of IIIT NIR Raipur. So this is it's mentioned that this is the first conference of the IEEE MP subsection, and also that it's the first conference of IIIT NIR Raipur. IEEE MP section, right? So this is the first conference of IEEE MP section, and also the first conference of the IIIT NIR Raipur. So in the both the cases, it's the first. So and this is the first vote of thanks by me for this first conference. Okay. So everything is come first. So now I propose the vote of thanks of this conference. So thank you. First of all, thank you. That's IEEE, right, to giving us this platform, and also that recognize this conference as a flagship conferences. So thank you Dr. Tomar and Dr. Mishra to providing all kind of supports to organizing and executing this all the logistics, because so many logistics are there when you are going to conduct this IEEE conference. Next, I like to thanks our director sir, who is constant motivate constantly, and it's a kind of that forcing that he should organize a conference, and with that motivation that finally we are reached in a one day that we can organize our first conference. So thank you sir for your constant motivation and support. Then I like to thank our sponsor, the Interval Technologies, Pune, and Integrated Microsystem, who provided our the support sponsor, and also that so many keynote speaker, session chairs, authors that who have submitted the paper to these conferences, and finally that reviewer who have given their the time, right, to review the paper and finally selected the 33% paper of submitted total paper. So I thank that all the keynote speakers, authors, and the reviewers. And also this is the special thanks to the organizer, right? We have conceived the entire idea and gone through the lot of different kind of technical, logistics, implementation issues, and finally that they bring us into this day, right? So that we can able to organize the our first conference. So thank you the organizer, organizing committee, okay, Dr. Majumdar, Dr. Paltani, Dr. Tiwari, Dr. Tripathi, and all others, chairs and the members. Okay, so there will be lot of organizing chair, lot of committee members of the, because in a conference there is many committees, and it is not that only four people or five people, right? So there are many people associated with the conferences and in the different committees. So I thank to each and everyone. And last not the least, that I thanks to the all faculty members, staff members of our institute. And if I miss anybody, so I extend my sincere thanks to anybody if I miss the name. So with that, I like to conclude my vote of thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I request Dean Research and Development, Dr. Punya P. Paltani, to present a token of memento to Dean Academics, Dr. Rajasri Mahapatra. Now I invite all the respected dignitaries, distinguished guests, faculty members, supporting staff, and students to join for high tea at the atrium. The next technical session will begin at 11:30 in JCB Hall, respectively. Thank you.
This is slide where I show the anechoic chamber. Can anybody let me know if you see my slide where I show the anechoic chamber? If you see, then I will do this way. Otherwise, I will go back without presentation mode.
सिस्टम चलेगा कैसे यार
सर इट्स कमिंग वेरी नाइसली यार
चलाओ ना इनको यार
थैंक यू If any yeah. question, let me know. So we have two
examples.
Please, there are some noise actually. So
yes, I have cancelled, sir. Please.
Okay. So I have one chamber here that goes to 40 gigahertz, and then we have a mini compact train that goes to 120 gigahertz, and of course we have some other component that help in the simulation design build of the. Of the antenna in my lab. My talk focuses on high gain antennas, and of course the 5G communication. Also now people have started working on 6G communication, where you go up to 140 gigahertz, and people are actually going 250 to 320 gigahertz also, some millimeter wave. Simply they're trying to build a massive MIMO or MIMO kind of technology to get more data throughput. But in my talk, I'm limiting 210 gigahertz range. So since you are going higher in frequency, your propagation losses go high, right? And therefore you have to have high gain antennas to set up the link, even though you may have low noise amplifiers, power amplifiers, or the transmit receive end. And when you do that, you have to certainly reduce number of antenna on the host platform, so that cost is reduced. At the same time, interference becomes a problem. So reduced number of antenna, better solution, multifunctional, that makes the gain cost saving. You have to also have, you know, swap, you know, defined for yourself. That means size, weight, and you know, power that comes to hand to become on your side. Basically, if you have reduced cost, then you have more market. Of course, if you have less power, that means you need lots of battery power requirement, weight, because nobody wants to have heavy system these days. So these are kind of desired features. Now there are two solutions one can do: one based on the reflector, one based on the phased array antenna. Although we have many other options, but in this talk I'm only focusing on these two solutions here. If it is a reflector antenna solution, then it tends to be high gain because you have bigger the aperture, more the directivity. But then turns out to be that it's a 3D structure. Therefore, it's not so low profile design, right, anymore. And of course, less expensive because simply have a metal sheet and some feed horn there. It mostly provides fixed beam, but if you want beam steering, then you have to employ special techniques. I will show you one case today in my presentation where we did beam steering with a reflector antenna. The second solution that you can get high gain as well as beam steering is the phased array solution, when simply you steer the beam as the user is moving. So you keep connecting it. And if you do that, and if you implement with the phased arrays these days, basically phase shifters, LNAs, HPs, the cost becomes a challenge. And on top, the complex beam farming board has to be there, and you need lots of DC power to run the chips that are involved in the array. So there are pros and cons of both solutions. And of course, both solutions are still debated and used as one can afford it. So the reflector antenna solutions that I'm presenting, not that they are coming from my books that I presented, but these something on the same line, and somebody is interested in reading more about feed reflectors, they can read from these books from Artec House that got published, and some of the other few sources that I had done here. But again, that's something not my point here. So if it is a reflector antenna solution, first thing to note, you need a bigger aperture. 20 wavelength to 1000 wavelength sometimes. Bigger the reflector surface, more the directivity. Since there is big aperture involved, your frequency has to be higher enough. Basically, if you are doing megahertz range, then you have a trouble because too big a surface. So generally, if people prefer to use one gigahertz, these days they use up to terahertz. Basically, for some Mars mission, they're using terahertz frequency, where they prefer to use reflectors, even of 1.5 meter reflectors for terahertz. So you get lots of directivity from the reflector surface. So how reflector antenna works? So simply what I'm describing from a symmetric parabolic reflector, I don't know what prerequisite is there with you to understand this discussion, but I'm going to go a bit slow here. So if you have a feed source at the focal point, you are going to illuminate a reflector surface. And your parabola has some equations to follow, such as noted here, where you have focal point distance given here, and if you are at any arbitrary point on the reflector surface, then you can calculate. Basically, if you have you use this equation, you can construct your own parabolic surface. Then since you have a feed here that illuminates the reflector, simply reflector is just a secondary structure in this case. Actual antenna is the feed source here that is sitting at the focal point. So when you illuminate the reflector surface, you create some current density, on the reflector surface, and once you have the current density, then you can integrate it and get the far field radiation pattern. But symmetric reflectors do have some disadvantages in the form that they have some blockage problem. Now, if you have a offset reflector, then you can reduce the blockage. Basically, your efficiency improves, your gain improves. One case shown here where you have no clearance, and here you have a clearance. Basically, all the feed source is just below the reflector surface. Basically, as big massive feed structure you can have, there's no blockage happening because of that. So, but then if you do offset reflector, automatically you have high cross polarization. Even though your feed has no cross polarization, a reflector has cross polarization because your reflector becomes asymmetric. Like here in case of parabola, you have symmetry there, upper half of the and the bottom half portion here, whereas here only one half portion of the reflector left for you. So you have some asymmetry coming along elevation plane, and therefore you do get a cross polarization, even though you don't have in the fields any cross polarization. So that's kind of thing to keep in mind. However, offset reflector does help you because as you can bring all the electronics, all the feed sources below the reflector, therefore you have a very nice performance. And now overall, this, it is very preferred for all SATCOM applications, and you can have large number of feed, basically you can have n number of feed sources, as long as they're offset, you can have n beams. So the people have done multiple beams these days using reflectors, right? Now, some more discussion on feed side here, and as well as reflector side. If you want a very good optimum design, your feed should be at the your feed at the phase center. Phase center is simply the fictitious point from where your electromagnetic radiation starts, right? So basically your phase center should be at the focal point, not the aperture at the focal point. That's what I want to clarify here. Aperture is not necessarily the best point, rather where phase center is the one where it should reside on the focal point. Basically, look at the phase center position of your feed and then locate that at the focal point for an optimal response. Having said it, your phase center is frequency dependent. So if your frequency changing, this phase center can go up and down here. Sometimes phase centers can be out of the structure, can be inside the structure. So determining phase center beforehand and then aligning with the focal point for the optimum response is a good thing to do. Now, when you do that, keep in mind that your pattern has to be symmetric. Like for this feed source I designed around 15 years back, I'm showing the feed pattern here. And your feed pattern with respect to point here, beam broadside in this case here, your pattern has to be as much symmetric as possible so that your reflector illumination is symmetric. And once you do that, then your reflector response will be very high in gain. And of course, second point, that there should be no cross polarization. Means, of course, no antenna you can design where you can say, I will have no cross polar. I mean, there is some cross polar because of the finiteness, right? So, but your effort should be to reduce the cross polarization. Means, as reduced cross pole, as better design. So that one should keep in mind. Certainly no random error on the surface. Basically, your reflector surface should be smooth enough. People prefer lambda by 100 order of smoothness. Basically, when you do it, when you machine it, the surface, you have to polish it. People say like a mirror. So if you can have lambda by 100 order, even if you have lambda by 30 to 40, it should be good enough design. So therefore, no phase error problem, and therefore design gets very good. And no blockage. Of course, they just say if it is symmetric reflector, like the one shown here, you are whatever feed source is here is blocking the energy after reflecting back from the reflector surface. But if it is offset, then you can eliminate that problem. That's why previous slide I talked about offset reflector. But offset reflector has some benefit, but then cross pole is a problem there. Another thing to keep in mind when you are eliminating the reflector surface, make sure you have most of the current on the reflector itself. Not much energy should go out, because if you have any energy going out, means you have a spillover loss, and that spillover loss will affect your overall response, and that can turn as a backlog in the radiation pattern. So here a example I'm showing where you can see most of the current is localized at the center of the reflector here, so we don't have much to worry. And it's the offset reflector, so you can see even though at the edge you have some current left in this case. Having said it, when you are designing a feed source, half edge illumination is a term to be keep in mind. So basically from center where you have the focal point to the edge, half edge of the reflector, basically how much energy control you have. So generally people use 10 dB criteria for most of the design, but it can also be 12 dB or 8 dB. So 8 dB is not the good news, but you have 12 dB, 15 dB, 20 dB, basically as much energy focusing you can do on the reflector surface, as good design you have. Having said it, you should not have any side lobes, because if any side lobes are coming to illuminate the reflector, they are going to radiate back and have a high side lobe from the reflector also. So you are only talking about the main beam. So peak to 10 dB down, peak to 12 dB down, half edge illumination basically is good news. And here I show the response. Yes, if you have 8 dB versus 12 dB half edge illumination, you can see that your gain slightly, you know, your gain slightly reduces, but the side lobe improves a lot. So if you have 8 dB side lobe 26 dB versus 12 dB half edge illumination 34.75, basically almost 9-8 dB of improvement in side lobe. And why side lobe improvement is critical? Because since a very high gain antennas, if you have another neighboring application, then you'll have interference, especially for a satellite communication. They have some ITU recommendations. Simply the RFCC recommend that you have not to spill over the energy in another subscriber or another service provider's area. If not, you will have interference problems. So they want to reduce that. That's why side lobe is very, very critical factor to have it in the day. So you want to reduce side lobe level as much you can. Reflectors tend to provide lower cross side lobe anyway because there's some tapering involved. So basically center, as you see here, in higher energy density, right? As you are going towards the edge, energy is already tapering out. It's like a non-uniform line. So already getting very nice tapering, very nice side lobe reduction, but still you want as low side lobe as you can have. So therefore, not only depending on the reflector surface, also making sure your feed is properly designed so illumination can be reduced, or a side lobe can be reduced, even though slight drop in main beam gain, which is not a big deal. So first example I'm going to show you is about a CubeSat design, 6U CubeSat design, which we designed at W-band frequency of 86 gigahertz. 6U means 1U is 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter cube. 6U means basically you have 30 centimeter by 20 centimeter, some structure like that, where antenna is only given a space of 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter. And it was, since it was for CubeSat application, it can lie around 500 to 1000 kilometer above the Earth, based on when CubeSat is going above you. So you have to have enough gain, and at the same time, of course, CubeSat can be used for many applications. But in our design, since we have very compact space here, so we had a very low FOVD, basically a very compact design. Basically, feed is very broad beam, so therefore we have a hard time designing a nice feed source as well as that reflector collects all the energy coming from the feed. So response is very good. And our target was 34 dBIC, basically circular polarization. And if we needed left-hand circular polarization from feed, this deflector is going to give right-hand circular polarization because of metallic sheet that inverts the field, right? In terms of polarization, if you go back to polarization loss factor discussion or others, discussions in your coursework, you can relate with that. As I said, we are using 86 gigahertz because here you have a low loss propagation window. And therefore, that's what we are trying to exploit in our application. So as part of the feed design, we have a simple cylindrical waveguide. We do not have big choke here because FOVD is 0.25 means we have a very broad beam requirement. So we did not need to make the beam narrow. But since we wanted circular polarization, so one way to generate circular polarization is that if you have the you're feeding at 45 degree to the pair of holes, like one shown here, when wave propagates, one wave will see cylinder edge, the one wave will see around the air holes here on the side, and therefore you have two components they are 90 degree from each other and equal in amplitude. And once you have that, that's when circular polarization happens. If you go back to basic equal amplitude, 90 degree time phase difference. So that was the method that we wanted to use to generate our circular polarization here. So here we show through this 0, 90, 180, 270, basically as time is passing, how fields are rotating and how circular polarization happens in this case. So we designed the feed. Of course, we have a paper. I will show the reference later on that you can read more information. But once you have the feed source, also since F over D is very small here, and this is the polished reflector surface of 10 centimeter effective aperture, and this is the feed source fabricated model here. And not only that, we designed the strut as part of the feed source in this case. So here we have a ground skirt, which is around the circular waveguide, because there are lots of current happening on the walls here, and those were causing problems. So with the ground current, we could balance the symmetry in the radiation pattern, as well as we could lower the cross polarization, we could improve the cross polarization simply. So that was a very integral ground skirt in our screen. So after we build it, and of course these fabrications at W1 frequency, if you have lambda by 100 kind of requirement of polishing the surface, it's not a conventional CNC machining. You have to have very high precision machining or electroforming technique to use that. Those who work in aerospace industry or satcom industry, they may know that information. So once we designed the feed, and of course we have to measure with reflector and without reflector. So if we have the feed horn alone, simulation measurement versus feed horn and reflector. The reason we did, even though a reflector and feed may be sitting in far field, but in our case, since F over is very small, we wanted to make sure there's not much interaction happening. So we verified that impedance matching is preserved over almost 10 gigahertz bandwidth. And if you see the axial ratio, it is, you can see, well below 2 dB or around 1 dB axial ratio throughout the 10 gigahertz bandwidth. Another point I want to mention for the young researchers, those who are working in this area, that when you look at the axial ratio, don't look at one single phi 0 or phi 90 plane or single broadside position. That's not right representation. Look at the axial ratio at different theta and phi, basically all around our full hemisphere. Look at it. So here we have theta variation as well as phi. You can see my axial ratio is very good all over the plus minus 30, 45 degree angle here in theta versus phi 0 to 180, which simply goes to 360 degree because 1/2 we are plotting to show the quality. So if you, and then we did the measurement of the feed in our lab, and we could verify that both simulation measurement at 79 as well as 86 gigahertz match well. So this is how you classify your feed source, that not only look at CP at one frequency or one point, or the look at the whole sphere, and then see that if my axial ratio is preserved, means my design will be preserved. Like this picture here, it is axial ratio at one point, whereas this contour plot is showing the whole, theta and phi positions. So that's something I would advise if you are dealing with this kind of problem. Then, of course, we measured the feed source in our lab here, both the simulation and measurement. You can see there is very good agreement. Certainly, some cross poles are higher than the simulations can show. And this is the, of course, simulation showing that all the current is localized on the reflector surface. We are not spilling much because F over D 0.25, so this is something to be checked. And we verified that our half-age illumination was 10.5 dB in this case. Basically, peak center energy, maximum energy to the edge energy was 10.5 dB. Basically, we are collecting most of the energy coming. And if you want 12 dB, basically, we have to have a very constrained design in this case. Since F over D is very small, so it was already very much challenging. So we measured the reflector response, as I showed the fabricated retina picture in our lab, and then not a single frequency measurement. Also, we looked at the versus frequency variation for CP gain as well as antenna efficiency. Antenna efficiency was more than 60%. And see, total antenna efficiency, not the aperture efficiency alone, basically all the factors considered together. And the gain was something around 34 dB range, which was the requirement from this project for CubeSat. And this is the measured 3D pattern in our chamber. So you can see that it is a nice pencil beam that you wanted. And after that, we also ran some cases with the CubeSat cases. You can see, you can have the antenna here, and it's the central area where the antenna is sitting in one huge space here. So that time, Tikra did not have that capability, but they do have now. So we used Ansys Savant, and then we studied, and it's not much, you know, difference when without the chassis and with the chassis. And that's something is very important to know, because metal piece can cause some scattering. And this project was funded from research. And if you need to read more about this work, please read RTP Transactions March 2019 journal paper. You will get tons of information about this design. We also did in my lab some 3D metal printed structures. Again, the reason I'm bringing this up, because 3D metal printing is low cost. It saves lots of money. Machining is costly. Metal machining or any high precision machine is very costly, where 3D metal printing can be low cost. So you can save almost 10 order of cost saving, basically, when this 3D metal printing machine, metal printing technology that matured. So in our case, simply we used a DMLS approach called direct metal laser sintering approach. And of course, we sent to a company, not that we have in my lab something. ProtoLab is the name of the company. We used aluminum alloy structures. It's not like complete alloy or complete aluminum or copper or something conductivity, but it's not make a big difference, because ohmic losses are very, very less, affected because of that. So. And also the one factor to note, since we are doing sintering here, so you will have uneven surface. So some 50 micrometer to 125 micrometer of surface roughness that you can see. Therefore, frequency range is a factor. So in our designs up to 30 gigahertz, you notice this 3D metal printing works well, but beyond that we had problems. So I would not recommend using this 3D metal printing beyond K band range or 30 gigahertz range. So in this paper, we noted here IEEE antenna wireless propagation later. We designed an axial corrugated horn here, basically. And then we, after building it, we have a K connector here, because at such high frequency, you cannot use SMH. So, and then you can see there is, if you see the closed view here, the surface is a little, not so smooth. And therefore, there will be some effect. Before we measured it, and of course we ran a tolerance study, and you can see that if you have the tolerance behavior, so there is some change that you can notice. And that's something we did beforehand, because we did not want to have surprise. So sometimes you need to do that to eliminate surprises at the when you have built something, you already invested some amount of money and you are testing it. So it's a good idea to do that. And simulations are, these days much more capable than they used to be. Both the scattering parameter as well as the radiation pattern at the lower end, 26.5 and 40 gigahertz, which is a very wide band, full Ka band design. So we tested the feed horn in my lab here, and you can see the simulation versus measurement S parameter. There is some disagreement, of course, because not only because of surface roughness, which can cause some problem, plus, of course, scattering when you're measuring S parameter, not in an echoic chamber, we're measuring out out of the chamber, so therefore some scattering can happen. But if you look at the radiation pattern, co-poles are very good in agreement, but the cross pole have higher energy, because also two factors: the noise floor of the chamber, as well as the where you are in the frequencies. The chamber goes up to 40 gigahertz, we are kind of approaching towards 40 gigahertz, and this cross pole level will go up. So that's something to keep in mind, not that all measurements are perfect, right? So because chamber are, although you are adding some unknowns here. And here, if you see the gain, some disagreement at the gain, because we are 37 gigahertz, very close to 40 gigahertz when my chamber frequency ends. So those things to keep in mind. And we did verify at different frequencies, 33 gigahertz as well as 40 gigahertz. And again, one thing we noticed, the cross poles were slightly higher, around 10 dB or more. But even though it's very small energy, but that shows that there is something happening. Had we done CNC machining in this case, we could have got very close to simulation. But just because we did 3D metal printing, so that's the thing. If you want to use 3D metal printing, be aware of that it is going to have some trade-off on the design response. But it's a low cost, you can realize in smaller in investment. We also did another K-band design using a 3D metal printing, as you can see in the picture here. But here we are looking for a dual circular polarization. So we published another paper where we had a polarizer structure, basically, where we presented that we have symmetric polarizing structure, then you have better axial ratio, better circular polarization quality here. So the height of the polarizing structure and the depth, again, as we propagate, so one wave will keep going as a cylindrical waveguide, another wave will hit this groove here, or you can say the gap here. Therefore, you will have two different path length. Again, you will have two different path length, means you have phase difference happening, and that phase difference is the one contributes to axial ratio. Here we have some tooth at the top here because we wanted to improve the pattern quality, and some choke in this case because this design was for F-body 0.6, and as well as it is K band at 27.5 to 28.3 gigahertz. Even though we got response much wider than that, from 26.5 to 29.5 gigahertz for 5G communication band actually. So simulation versus measurement response, if you see for impedance matching, they turn out to be very well. Again, the reason we have two ports, because one provides right hand CP, second other one provides left hand CP. So dual CP, basically one you can use, one for transmit, one for receive. The isolation between the two ports has to be there, because if isolation is bad, basically the cross coupling will happen, right? So we could get reasonable acceleration, 20 dB or better, isolation between the two port. And if you want to do better, of course, you have to go back to the distal domain or basement domain in this case. Now, if you see the acceleration quality, once again, versus theta and phi, we have very broad acceleration range here below 3 dB, if you see the criteria here. So basically, you have not to worry about acceleration quality as you are using this design at different phi and theta angles. So this is very, very good. Again, I think I showed this plot earlier, and we did look into the aperture illumination from the feed source. And then we measured the axial ratio as well as the gain in our chamber, and we got a very good agreement between simulation and measurement. And again, I did not mention, but my chamber has a capability where we can do sense of rotation measurement as well as the, of course, gain. So this is the case when we have measured axial ratio for the both polarizations, at least for, I'm showing one single frequency. And you can see very nice beam quality maintained, or this very nice axial ratio quality maintained from the feed. And then we measured the radiation pattern. Again, you can see co and cross separation is not, not bad here, something around 20-30 dB down, especially at theta angle here at even at theta some 20 some degree here, you can see still better than 20 dB cross poles. So it was a very good feed design from that perspective. We could maintain in this case 12 dB half edge illumination. As I said, 10 to 12 dB, 15 dB, as much energy focusing you can do, as better reflective response you have. Here our goal was to create five multiple beams. So we use a spherical reflector. Although I'm not showing those responses here for some reason, but then one can, and we had some conference paper on that and journal paper, we have not written it. So but then we use 25 by 35 centimeter rim for the spherical reflector here, and you can see that to the responses as well as the HFSS response compared very well. So keep in mind, when design the feed source, look at the half edge illumination. From center to edge of the reflector, you must have all the focusing going on. And the circular polarization, if you are doing that, then keep mixed axial ratio is well maintained. And co and cross separation is maintained. Isolation is maintained if the two port design, such as dual port. Like in another case, I show you, a V-band design, that 50 gigahertz design we did in our lab. So again, this paper was published in WPL, last year. We have port 1, port 2, basically, let's say one is right-hand CP, second one is left-hand CP. But in this case, the difference is that we have only one side of the polarizer. And that simply gives you little asymmetry That's why later on we the previous design I showed when we have symmetric polarizer structure, that's much better. But anyway, here we have simple one sectoral, you know, polarizing structure. We did verify amplitude and phase, 90 degree phase, equal amplitude. Then since we couldn't do, in this case, we built a 3D metal printed design, but it did not perform well because this small polarizing section was completely filled with the metal, simply response could not happen. So we have to go to machining. So in machining, you know, we have to make in two pieces, and this is the polarizing structure here where I have my, you know, laser point here. And once you do that, yeah, you have to have proper, you know, screws, otherwise small gap will have current leakage. Then we did verify their impedance matching and axial ratio, as well as radiation pattern responses. Since I said something like that earlier, I'm not going to stress more, but the only thing I want to leave to the interested researchers that when you design feed sources, give attention to the matching bandwidth, give attention to the isolation, give attention to the axial ratio response and pattern symmetry, as well as its spillover plus know the phase center, if you want to get the best reflector response from that. So with that, I'm going to end some reflector discussion. Rather, I'm going to start some discussion on some phase array antenna projects we did, but a few of them at least. I published a book this year alone in May, April time from IEEE Press and Wiley. Those interested in multifunctional antennas, including reflector, including phase array, to as well as the reconfigurable and tunable designs, are long before me. So, if you want to read, you have tons of information in the book, and you can gain some insight. So, going back to phase array topic here, what is the phase array antenna? A phase array antenna is simply a collection of the radiating elements placed in a certain fashion, which is called lattice, array lattice, basically square lattice, rectangular lattice. Like here, if you see here, I have a square lattice here, right? Basically, if I go along this side or along here, they have same inter-element spacing. So it's square lattice. You can have rectangular lattice as well as you can have circular lattice. Basically, how you arrange the rating elements. And that gives you the different array factor response. So you have to be aware about that. Plus, you can have a passive array design. You can have an active where you have LNH, HPH all combined. Like in my designs I show here, I have both LNH, HPH as in the form of chips here. You can see one rating element and one chip here. And each chip has itself all the LNH, HPH, phase shifters, variable gain amplifiers in one place. So this is an active phase array design. One can have digital beamforming these days when you are doing something in the RF domain, something you are doing in the digital domain. And by collecting the amplitude phase from the radiators, you can manipulate them. So what is the phase array antenna? If you just go back to very basic concept here, simply you are delaying the fields, right? So if you have 0 degree phase here, your field is free to radiate. As you have delta phi, 2 delta phi, 3 delta phi, basically you're simply delaying the signal. So since you're delaying the signal, you have a slope now. Therefore, you are simply tilting the beam in a given manner by applying a particular progressive phase shift, or 0 delta phi, 2 delta phi, the difference is delta phi. So it's called progressive phase shift. Therefore, you have to have a phase shifter involved in case of a beam steering solution. If you do not have phase shifter, you will have fixed beam design. And of course, you will have still power dividers and all those things involved. So first thing to keep in mind before you start designing a phase array that have a broad rating element pattern, like the red dot that I show you, that's the element pattern that I said I want to get it. And because if it is broad pattern, then I can scan farther. If you have very high gain antenna as a feed element and you have narrow beam, your scan range will be very, very, restricted. So therefore, we need a broad element pattern requirement. Therefore, I can scan farther. So keep in mind, design rating element that gives you broader beam width. And then once you have done that, you have to have inter-element spacing selection like DX or DY. Again, if you have a square lattice or rectangular lattice, and how much DX, DY you can choose. There is again a chicken and egg problem. Simply, you have more inter-element spacing, you have more directivity, but you see the grating law problem. Now, if it is too close, dx dy is too small, then your directivity suffers, and you do not have any grating law problem, but cross-polarization becomes an issue. So people tend to use 0.5 to 0.6 wavelength just to be for reasonable designs. Of course, that's some, but it is a parameter that you can use. And also look at the active S parameter, basically element to element, how coupling is going to happen. Especially when we say active S parameter, we start with simply excite one element and other elements are matched terminated, and we see the mutual coupling response. So that's something to keep in mind. Look at the active S parameter when you design phase day, not only the only passive S parameter. That's not the sole descriptor here. You have to also have proper beam forming network, because how you manipulate the amplitude and phase. So, and that's the major complex part, how amplitude phase are coming to play the role here. That means how amplitude is being controlled. And so you have to have, if it is received, low noise amplifier, phase shifters, variable gain amplifier. If it is transmit, then you have power amplifier. Of course, it goes behind, but at least a power amplifier, phase shifter, and variable gain amplifiers. And then you collect all those amplitudes coming from each of the radiators through this power feed network. And if you are receiving, then you are collecting in one place, right? If you are transmitting, you are doing the reverse process there. But since you are electronic beam steering, you have to have proper beam forming algorithm, like the one shown here through the GUI here, that you can control from a laptop, and then simply your amplitude and phase is being manipulated. So this equation shown here simply gives you the feeling of amplitude and the phase that is going into the array factor, and therefore you can get a proper design. Plus, you need to have a beam forming algorithm. What math you are applying to control the amplitude and phase? That's something should be kept in mind also. I'll show one, I think, because time is limited, I will show one example, then I'll stop today, and I will have some question answer if you have anything. So again, we designed a W-band application phase array design here at around 86 gigahertz. Again, where propagation window permits low propagation loss. And then it was, again, one use space on the CubeSat on the surface of one of the use space here. Again, going back to the application, it's remote sensing application for SATCOM. So since you need circular polarization, we came up with a new rating element, you can say, called butterfly rating element, where we have four kind of patches placed such a way that they give you circular polarization. You can see from the surface current distribution 0, 90, 180, 270, as you are changing, your current is rotating to give you circular polarization property. Another thing to keep in mind, since we are using a series fed array here, generally people prefer to use 16 elements, but we noticed there are lots of current left. Therefore, it was not utilizing all the current going on the rating elements. So basically, we increased the size to 24 and as well as 32, and we noticed 24 element in one series fed design is more optimum than to use 16 element or 32 lots of losses here. And you can see from this efficiency calculation that why we chose 24 rating element here. Again, this paper that is there in our pre-transaction in December of last year. If you want to read more, and we have all the analytical equations, all the physics going on included there. And two butterfly elements are basically placed at one electrical wavelength, so that you do not have any phase coming to discount the beam beyond the series fed case in this case here. So we made a fixed beam design, 8 cross 24, as well as we made 32 cross 24 array design, which is kind of one full one use space. We have a W band connector, 1 millimeter connector here, and we verified their impedance matching as well as radiation patterns here. Since it is a series fed array, you will have some squinting happening. So we look at plus minus 1 degree squint area. That's where we can say acceptable pattern quality. And then we see the impedance matching and the axial ratio. And in this case, we could get the gain something around 20 dB. If it is the 8 class 24, and if it is the 32 class 24, then of course we could get 23, 24 DPR in this case. And it's, again, these things were, these antennas were verified in my chamber. We also looked into its beam steering solution, where we designed our own 4-bit phase shifters with silicon germanium 19 nanometer technology. And then we had a, we bought commercial on the shelf LNH, and we made 8 class, you know, 24 array, just as a prototype testing here. And then after testing, of course, you know, we published some work in the symposium. After that, we have to refabricate this design because it's multi-layer board, and one of the layers got mirrored. And once we have that refab, we'll have the beam steering response. So far now, I do not have beam steering response for this case. I want to stop at this moment here because I know I'm exceeding timeline. So I will have some time for question and answer.
We are very thankful for your presentation on the topic innovative high gain antennas for enhanced wireless and satellite communication applications. Sir, I would like to invite Dr. Sri Vishal Tripathi to speak about the session.
So very good afternoon to all of you here. Now the session is open for the question and answer here, so you may ask the queries with the sir. Okay, so you make up this one. Okay, so you may come this one.
Good afternoon, sir.
Hello, how are you? Yeah, go ahead.
Fine, sir. Fine, sir. Sir, my question is, what is the way to measure the efficiency of antenna, sir?
To measure the efficiency of the antenna, certainly the best is that you integrate the energy right over the sphere. That means you are doing the 3D measurement, right? Like I showed in the previous case here, where I did the 3D measurement of the feed horn. You know, let me go back to that slide so I can show you that here. So basically, you have to do the 3D measurement, 3D pattern measurement, basically, right? And once you do the 3D pattern measurement, you can integrate the current, right? Rather, you know how much power is being radiated, right? Compared to how much input power was coming at the port. And then that's the ratio that gives you antenna efficiency. So if you have an equate chamber, try to measure 3D pattern. Then you can get the efficiency. Or if you have heard about star systems like from Satimo star systems, they have, so they have array of probes on a surrounding there, and they pick the energy from all directions, and that's how they calculate the radiated power, and they compare with respect to the power going, and then set the efficiency. So that's the best way to measure the antenna efficiency. Now, if no one has that capability, then you can go to Wheeler cap method, right, where you can create a cavity based on some dimensions. There are some paper known as Wheeler cap method to determine the quality factor and antenna efficiency. Then you can go that route. But that tends to be very frequency sensitive and it's not so accurate. So to answer your question, do the 3D measurement. And that's how you can do the antenna efficiency measurement.
Yes, sir. So my second question is, what should be the acceptable range of cross polarized level?
That's a very good question, but that depends upon the application, right? If it is long distance communication or high gain antenna design, then you need at least 15 dB low cross pole, right? Go to cross separation should be 15 dB. But that's not acceptable for satellite applications. For SATCOM applications, for radar, since you are talking about very weak signal, nanowatt range sometimes. So you need 30 dB cross polarization, 20 dB cross polarization. So 15 dB is not acceptable. Now, going back to wireless communication application, let's say base stations, right, in our cell phone applications, then you can have 15 dB also. So it's application dependent. So cross pole range depends upon the application, right? SATCOM needs very huge difference between co and cross, 40 dB, 30 dB. Radar, 30 to 40 dB cross pole separation. But if it's conventional wireless communication, you can be okay with 15 dB. application dependent.
Okay, sir. My third question is, sir, what are the challenges in high frequency antenna design, sir?
Can you again repeat your question?
Yes.
What are the challenges in high frequency antenna design, sir?
That's a very, very, very smart question. So if you go to high frequency design, first thing, what you mean by high frequency? You mean 30 gigahertz? I think millimeter wave, this is high frequency. 15 gigahertz Ku band is a high frequency also. But I think what you're meaning by millimeter wave here, if you go 30 gigahertz to 100 gigahertz range or 110 gigahertz range, so what happens, the main challenge is the fabrication. In simulations, you can do whatever you want, right? But when you are going to build it, how you'll get that surface accuracy? How you'll get substrate material that is not adding up the loss? Like in our W band design that I showed you here, that is based on microstrip, you know, we had rolled edge copper, you know, this design that I show you, it's rolled edge copper, only 10 mil the substrate thickness. And you can see, and then fabrication, it's micrometer, a few micrometer of accuracy has to happen there. So how can you build such a structure? And these are, I paid $10,000 to build these structures, very small pieces, because that's where the fabrication technology came to help. So yes, as you go higher in frequency, fabrication is a challenge. And then of course, characterization in chamber or how you're testing, that's a challenge. But simulation is easy to run, okay? So keep in mind how we are going to feed like 1 millimeter connector here, because as you go higher in frequency, you cannot use conventional SMH, right? They tend to be very, very lossy. They will behave as a distributive line parameters, right? So you don't want to use that. So choosing proper connectors, choosing proper fabrication technology, choosing proper substrate material with low dielectric loss and low ohmic losses, and then how to measure it, what characterization facility you have. Those are the challenges you should keep in mind.
Yes, sir. My last question is, sir, what do you think about the fabrication facilities in India if any researcher want to carry on their research?
Technically, I don't have the answer for that, but I have had some students from India.
Let me reframe his question. The intention was if we compare the measurement scenario in the most of the Indian labs here, so they don't have such kinds of high frequency measurement facility and the measurements tool here. So how they can be connected with your lab here or get an opportunity to work some semester here, which could be helpful in their career advancement here?
Yes, that can be done. Of course, we have some different programs, basically based on Indian government fellowships. You apply those and you come and work in my lab and complete the remaining work here. We have also done some collaborative work with different universities in China and India and other, Brazil, other countries, where we had this kind of some portion done at India, in this case, some portion done in my lab. So we can come up with some agreement if it is a challenging project. If it is just a design, I'm not going to waste my energy, right? So I have to have some proper reasoning why I'm collaborating with you. So if you have a good project, challenging project, yes, we'll find a way to work together, okay?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Okay.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening the audience here with your knowledge and wisdom here. So any other question from anyone here? Because he collected the questions from others here and he was asking him on this forum. So sure, if anyone has any other? Okay. So it seems that there is no further question from the audience here. So before this session, keynote session is going to end here, let me share a small story with you all here. This genesis of this talk is not started from the last 1 year here. This is started sometime in 2013 in IEEE AEMC Bhuneshwar. And you all will be surprised that at that time I was in PhD here, pursuing from IIT Jodhpur, and that was my first IEEE conference, and sir was the session chair. So I got an opportunity first time to interact with the sir here. And being my first IEEE conference, let me tell you frankly, I was slightly nervous at that time here. But as a session chair, sir's motivation was quite helpful here. And along with that, After there was a one talk of the sir here on related to the patch antenna work here, and let me tell you one thing here. There's a talk which has included his work here and explain all the things here. Changed my perspective to look up the patch antennas here. I was just in the beginning of my career and looking forward for some key inputs here, where how could be the research for a PhD scholars could be here in the next coming years here. From that time, I was having in mind to connect with the sir here, and IEEE TRIES 2021 flagship conference of IEEE MP section here. Being a coordinator, I got an opportunity to connect with the sir here, and immediately I requested the sir here, and I requested sir around a year ago. Last year I requested sir here, and sir was very kind to respond here. I will drop in mail and the next day, because there is a time lag here. Here it is near the afternoon here, but sir is close to the midnight there. But that was a dedication and commitment here where sir has given at that time. Even at the midnight in the USA, he is here to help us out here. This is a live example of dedication and commitment here. Being a young researcher here, inspired, this is a live example where you can learn here. Because every time we come up with the excuses here, but from being so busy, even from the brief bio, that was the utmost brief I can say we can have here. If you go in the detail, sir website here, you will find many pages here from his contribution to the society here.
I think you are giving some more good words for me, but I'm a researcher like you, and we have to work hard, and we have to make a disciplined research. You know, that's when you can accomplish things that you want for your, you know, students as well as yourself as a researcher, as a professor, right? And I think being a professor, you in this position, you have a good responsibility to, you know, mature smart researchers. Yes, you have to work hard, and I work 24/7. That's how I say it. Workaholic, you may say, but that's how I can do good things, and I think everybody is the same way. So thank you very much for your nice word, a nice encouraging word for me. Okay, thank you.
So along with that, just a small token, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Just a small token, sir, from our side.
Mm-hmm.
To you here, sir. Actually, we want to give you in the physical mode here, sir.
Mm-hmm.
But due to this ongoing pandemic, we are not able to do so here. We will keep you, sir, and next time once you are in India, just inform us. Definitely, I would like to host you here, sir. IEEE here.
Oh, sure. Thank you. In case, so I'm sure we'll meet in person.
Collaborative us here.
Yeah, sure. We'll meet in person.
Until then, this is with us here.
Oh, thank you. Okay, thank you. I appreciate it.
Okay, once again, thank you, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, Manoj.
Yes, sir. How are you, sir?
Yeah, totally fine, please. It's my really privilege to.
After a long time, I have seen it. Sir, just a minute here. Okay, so a very good afternoon, everyone, and all the participants, those who are presenting. So we are now starting our afternoon session. So in this session, basically, we will cover the 1 kilonode address, and there will be, after the kilonode address, there will be 3 parallel sessions will be there, and these 3 parallel sessions will be conducted in the one in the Jesse Bose Hall, another one is the C.V. Raman Hall, and the third one is the Benjamin Shah Hall. So today, actually, this time we will be conducting the keynote session, and the keynote session will be delivered by Professor Brijesh Kumar from MMMUT Gorakhpur, UP, India. So as a short profile, Professor Brijesh Kumar completed his M.Tech in the VLSI design from UP Technical University, Lucknow, And he has completed his PhD from IIT Roorkee in the area of VLSI design and organic electronics in 2014. He has more than 150 publications in the different journals and conferences referred. His current research area includes the microelectronics and organic devices. He has more than 22 years of teaching and industrial experience. He is associated with the international journals, including the IETE, IEEE Transactions, Elsevier, Springer's, etc. And today, he will be delivering the talk on the recent development in organic electronic material-based devices and circuits and its applications. So now I am requesting, sir, you may please start your talk. And I am sure that from your talk, the people and the participants will get benefited. And
thank you very much, Manoj. Really, I'm really lucky to have the interaction, this innovative talk, right? So I'm sharing my PPT. Yeah, it is visible to everyone. So, as discussed by Dr. Manoj Kumar Majumdar, today's the topic of talk is recent development in organic electronics material based devices and circuits and its application. So, initially, just my statement regarding, because this organic electronics based devices and circuits, similar way people are worked for MOSFET devices in 1960s. Same condition presently people are working, though displays commercially available. But as for concern of organic TFT devices, people are having a little bit availability of materials is there, but fabrication process and that. So based on the, so please don't compare this with silicon, because this we are talking about alternative options for organic material based devices, right? So where I will cover here. So the outline for this, what is the motivation behind talk and important landmarks in the organic material based devices and circuits. And just classification of organic and inorganic based devices, and what are the key applications where we can look for the research point of view. So recently, a lot of people are working in the area of organic material based devices, especially I have considered for discussion organic thin film transistor, where different we can improve the performance of device based on the layer, different thin film materials, different structures, and what are the impact of electrode thicknesses, channel impact, semiconductor dielectric thicknesses, and apart from that, dielectric or various interfaces. Okay? And a few examples I included for organic light emitting diode and organic solar cell. So currently with me, 8 PhD scholars are registered in the area of organic material based devices. So few are working on organic thin film transistor, and organic light emitting diode and solar cells. So recently I collaborated with the different institutions and university for, because presently we don't have fabrication facility. So for the point of fabrication, we have collaborated with different institutions. So these are the scholars and MTech and scholars associated with me. And I have inter-institution research supports from, I know everyone is aware, since 2010, and recently IIT Bombay further started and ISC Bangalore, similar kind of projects. So those who have connected through this, please go through this IIT Bombay site. You can, those who have interested in different area, so they can join in the area of organic material-based devices and circuits, and apart from other also. And I did my PhD from IIT Roorkee, so still I am associated with my professors at IIT Roorkee. They have developed the facility. Apart from that, Amorpha Semiconductor Laboratory, we have set up in Madan Mohan Malviya University of Technology, Gorakhpur. and also with the associated NPL. So these are the just awareness. So INOP has started recently. This month I received the call from INOP. So please, those who have interested in the area of organic material based devices, circuits, and so they can go through this. Registration is open still. So landmark, important landmark regarding the how these people initiated the work in the area of organic electronics. So initially in 1970s, so researcher realized that they have identified the polymer. So pure form of polymer is insulator, but late 1976, that discovery and development of conducting polymers by the Shirakawa and group created the research field. So for same work, they in 79 initially demonstrated amorphous hydrogenated silicon based device on the glass substrate. Later on, same they have initiated the work in 1976 development of conducting polymer. For that, they have been awarded the Nobel Prize. Right, Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2000 was given for the same work that initiated in 1976. Thereafter, based on this conducting polymer, in 1986, first organic TFT is demonstrated properly. So this, you can say, the work based on device that is initiated in 1986. Same, initially I had given the statement, like 1950 or 60s between MOSFET is developed similar way, 1986 for the first OTFT, or we can call it if we are using organic polymer as a conducting channel or organic material based semiconductor channel. So this either we call it organic thin, this OTFT or PTFT. Right. So that different thing based on this organic means a small molecule or conductive polymer. Right. So based on that, it can be defined as organic TFT or polymer TFT. Then here we have this table is showing the comparison between three technology, where single crystalline silicon based and amorphous silicon and organic TFT. This. So here in range of this temperature, we can go through that if we go for single crystal silicon based devices, the ultra clean room is required where we can maintain the temperature and all. So greater than 1000 degrees centigrade or more than 800 degree temperature we can maintain for the silicon based devices. Whereas in the case of amorphous silicon, this required less than 250 degrees centigrade. And that can be fabricated on glass. And in case of organic thin film transistor, this can be in this ambient temperature. In the rooms itself, we can fabricate the device. So it not required huge investment, because to set up any ultra clean room, it required crores and crores rupee, right? Whereas in case of organic TFT, it has low cost fabrication. That's why based on this device, applications are very low cost. So it can be used paper and the plastic substrate materials for the purpose of fabrication. So this comparison between among all three technologies, silicon crystal silicon, this single crystal silicon, amorphous silicon, and organic TFT. Apart from that, why we call it organic devices, and what is the merit of this? What is the feasibility of organic devices? So here we can go through. Organic devices consist of thin film structures, layered by layered. We deposit one layer over that another. Suppose initially substrate over that gate, then dielectric layer, then organic semiconductor channel. Then apart from that, top is the source and drain. So it can be called bottom. Gate top contact devices. So here semiconductor materials are used for the conducting polymer or a small molecule. And what is the key interest in organic devices, where we can aware process at low temperature, low cost fabrication, as we discussed, not required ultra clean room, foldable and bendable and lightweight, that also help for different places we need lightweight and flexibility. So it is also having a beautiful this compatibility with flexible substrate. So and in medical especially, people are looking for medical applications where smart cloths can be required this flexibility, and that can be possible compatibility with flexible substrates where paper, plastic, fiber and cloth and foil can be used for the purpose of substrate. Here we can discuss based on the difference between organic and inorganic semiconductors. So here five parameters we have considered for the difference: temperature, flexibility, process, condition and substrate material. So as I discussed in comparison between technology, so greater than 800 degrees centigrade is required for inorganic, whereas organic is room temperature. Then this inorganic materials is nature fragile in nature, whereas in organic is flexible. Inorganic is fragile in nature and organic is flexible. Then in inorganic or silicon based devices required multi-step photolithography, and in case of organic it is it can be continuous direct printing. So what is the benefit of continuous direct printing? If we need everyone is aware about that silicon based display is having limitation of 1 square meter, whereas in case of organic we can 10 feet by the width or length can be anything because of the direct printing. So roll to roll we can print the, suppose somebody want 20 feet length in the room they want to display, so it's possible with organic semiconductor material based display. It is the limitation of silicon is 1 square meter only. So that is the great means benefit of organic material based devices or display. And the condition required for this ultra clean room is required in case of silicon based devices, whereas ambient process is used in case of organic. And what kind of substrate here? Rigid glass, metal or silicon material used in the silicon and flexible plastic substrates. My voice is clear to everyone? Because this virtual, so somebody can reply, respond. Yes, my voice is coming?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, here, based on the comparison, this what is the merit of organic and inorganic semiconductor? So here I compare this all 6 parameter where you can see here the cost wise cost of the organic electronics, so $5 per square feet, whereas in case of this inorganic it goes to 100, and the fabrication cost it required low cost, whereas to set up the ultra clean room or multi-step photolithography setup 1:10 billion is required. And the device size in case of organic, as I discussed in previous also, 10 feet into roll to roll. So it can be, and according to your required length, we can develop the display size. Whereas in silicon based, less than 1 square meter is the limitation, where this limitation. So organic devices is having this flexibility. We can go at higher, means large electronics application, large area electronics applications for display. Then fourth, now flexible plastic substrate is the material here in silicon, ambient processing, ultra clean room, and this continuous direct printing. As we aware that spin coater, this inkjet printing can be used, whereas in case of silicon, multi-step photolithography is required to go for this. Then as per concern of which kind of device we can fabricate in organic material by using organic material, so here we can see, please concentrate on this first statement. This organic electron is not a technology competing with silicon. This initially statement I have given, it is just alternative, right? It is not competing with silicon, because silicon having much higher this, as I discussed this, you can see this here, the cost versus performance. So here we, if we go for our target is flexibility, then we can go for organic. So here we can see a large area, the benefit of organic, low cost and easy manufacturing, right? Whereas silicon waste is high speed application. If you if required high speed application, we cannot go for organic devices, where we can go for silicon only. So high speed, high performance, ultra low power, and this ultra miniaturization is required, right? And what is this? High temperature is required, right? But other is, if we our target is, right, speed and performance, then we go for silicon. If we, our target is low cost, then we go for organic, like different this malls where lakhs and lakhs items are available. So where, if we go for organic waste RFID tag, few cents of the cost. Otherwise, quite high, huge cost is involved in it. So that's why this organic electronics is not a technology competing with silicon. It's an alternative. But what we get with this organic, it intends for innovative applications that are either not possible or too expensive with silicon devices. So that's why our, initially I also told this, our target is we compromise with speed, then we go for this low cost. Organic semiconductor have brought exciting new opportunities for broad impact requiring thin film device architecture, right, where this thin film structures are required, where organic can be just one option. Thus, OSC have appealed for broad range of device, including we aware about that TFT, PTFT, or polymer based transistors and organic based transistors. Similarly, organic diodes, flexible organic diodes, solar cells, organic solar cells, organic light emitting diodes, and organic sensors. Few years back, I interacted at IIT Bombay. They have developed the IC that diagnoses the disease at they can means give the symptoms of disease by paying only 50 rupee. So that low cost that circuit they have developed at IIT Bombay. So similar kind of applications can people, one of my student developed the this, you know, one given the concept how we can detect the ovarian cancer by using light this OLED. So it's a good option he has proposed, and that very soon that proposal accepted by that KGMU Lucknow Medical University. So in the pipeline, the that area, how we can utilize this organic material based this light emitting diode for the means hardware, how we can develop the hardware. Concept is given by PhD students, so they working on it. So this slide is showing various, apart from organic solar cell, light emitting diode, transistors, sensors, other applications of organic devices. So in the case of this given various, so here you can see organic this flexible OLED e-papers, so that can replace the hard copy of the newspaper. OLED technology, so these two options means flexible OLED and e-paper. E-technology, this side, if we go for LCD technology, so this flexible LCD memory devices, organic memory. During my PhD program, I worked on organic SRAM. So we have given the concept how we developed the full concept of the organic SRAM device memory. Then sensor technology, so it can also be used image sensor. Then other technology, smart fabric, smart cards can possible with the low cost smart card is possible. by using this technology. If we go for this side, IC technology, smart card RFID tag. Everyone is aware that a few year back, US built RFID tag where a few of the Indian students, right, targeted, and they have fixed this RFID tag. So that RFID tag, if that is flexible RFID tag, so is simply can be inserted in the skin. So possible, right? So a smart card and RFID tag. So because a smart card is required for we can keep anywhere not damaged, so lot of that. And the RFID tag we required for low cost, because if we fix RFID tag in millions items, that cost reduce for based on the organic material. Apart from optical technology, organic lasers are used and biosensors. So a lot of people are working in these areas presently. Apart from this, everyone is aware as per concern of what is kind of operating principle apply for organic devices. So everyone is aware about the MOSFET. That's why I added this slide, where we aware in the MOSFET, we use inversion concept of the channel formation, inversion concept of the inversion. So here we can simply see the MOSFET device structure. So here we can see the how channel is formed. So inversion concept is applied. So majority of electrons and from source and drain side and from channel. Right? So this P-type substrate is hold. We can see this entire P-type substrate is inverses affected the electrons and from the minority carrier from the substrate, as well as electrons collected from the source and drain, heavily doped source and drain. So this channel is formed here by applying the gate voltage. So that is the concept of inversion. In case of organic TFT, the concept is accumulation layer. Right? So accumulation is take place, the channel formation or through accumulation. So organic thin film transfer uses, here we are aware about this. If we go for this organic semiconductor material, this organic semiconductor material here, this, right? So where organic, rather using silicon as a active layer material, right? Organic semiconductor material is used for the channel. It consists of a thin film structure usually named as basic in comparison to, right, on the basis of relative position of source and drain. So various structures are there, BGTC, BGVC, and dual gate also can possible. So channel is formed through accumulation, right? So here we can see, if we apply the negative gate voltage here, this we consider the P-type material. Substrate of this OSC material is P-type, then we can apply negative gate voltage. So this showing the, suppose we applied this 7 electrons this side, so this working as a parallel plate concept, so this side is P-type. So this, so gate voltage is applied for the channel formation, whereas VGS applied for the current control. So this collection from injection of carriers from this side, so source side, right, accumulated at the near the channel. So this channel formed here. So accumulation of carriers from source side to channel, this concept is accumulation because of the gate voltage, negative gate voltage applied here. So organic TFT, this channel formation based on accumulation. How we can improve the performance parameter, and how the performance parameter, what is the parameters required to have high performance OTFT. So here I listed a few parameters and written here this last line, what is the status of, what should be the status of drain current, mobility, threshold voltage. So if we go for high performance device, means we should have high drain current, then high mobility, threshold always we want device should be operated at lower voltage. So threshold voltage should be low. transconductance should be high for organic devices here, and the current or current on-off current ratio. On-off current ratio can be controlled by either we can minimize I-off or we increase the this IDS. So here, because this everyone is aware regarding the organic TFT, still these devices are high dimension devices. That's why low leakage. So I-off is minimum in case of OTFT for large dimension devices are fabricated. And sub-threshold slope and contact resistance should be low. So these are the parameters taken care during the extraction and fabrication. How we can, what are the different scope, how we can work in the area. So research scope for organic transistors is especially considered here. So a lot of people are working in chemistry, people are working for development of different organic materials. So if I have, because if we go for as per concern of mobility or material performance, we are aware about silicon based material having high mobility, where in case of organic semiconductor material, so p-type material having higher mobility in case comparison to n-type. As we are aware about in silicon based, n-type having higher mobility and p-type having lower mobility, 450 and 350. Similar way in case of organic material, p-type materials are having higher mobility. Recently reported around 15 centimeter square per BS, n-type hardly around 1 centimeter square BS. So very low mobility devices, organic material, organic TFT is very low mobility devices. So that's why initially we have stated it is used for display application, switching device for display especially. And so one of the area is people are working, develop the materials, then different device structure by which we can improve the performance. As earlier people work MOSFET, then FinFET, then different TFET kind of thing. So similar different means single gate based devices, dual gate based devices, cylindrical devices. So it can people can go for different structures as per their application requirement. Then channel length, because these devices having large channel length devices, so a lot of people are working how we can optimize the size of the device. Then electrode thickness can be also take up as a one of the research area. And this too is very important area where a lot of people are working. Organic and dielectric thicknesses, different organic materials also people are be aware of. PMMA, polymethyl methacrylate, is the initially developed as a organic dielectric material, and P.PSS as a electrode material, P.PSS as a electrode materials metal. And different interfaces impact also analyzed by different peoples. So these are the six area can we take up to improve the device of organic transistors. Then one by one, I just have 1 or 2 minutes for what can we have attempted and what people can attempt. So materials for different dielectric. So here we can go for materials at different layers, affects the device performance significantly. What is the impact due to difference in their properties? So energy band gap, affinity, temperature tolerance, work function, supporting fabrication process, and adhesiveness at lower layer. So this also have the impact due to different properties. Then electrode materials, charge injection and extraction. As we discuss in the diagram, injection directly take place through source and accumulated at channel. So if we have large channel injection area, then carrier are more and we can have higher drain current, means ion of current. So charge injection and extraction, then contact OSE interface between means work function difference between electrode material and organic semiconductor material that also have the impact on the performance. Substrate material affects flexibility of device and fabrication process. So this can be taken up as another area. Organic semiconductors, this channel material, so charge accumulation, you have the impact of this affect the performance. And self-trapping of carriers. We are aware about the traps are, it depends on the thin film developed. What is the process is opt for the development of the thin film. According to that, if surface of the thin film is very, very smooth, then traps are less. Device mobility and solution processability. What kind of this organic semiconductor material and what is the solvents availability? So that affects the solubility of that material. Then dielectric material affects device capacitance, threshold voltage, then dielectric OSE interface and different dipoles formation. So these are the, as we discussed in previous slide, we have, I have listed here the parameters. So people can take up these in depth because mathematical models is similar to MOSFET. So they can apply same model for organic devices. As we are aware that Shockley equation is applied for the to extract the all the performance parameter as discussed in previous slides, all the parameters. Then here different organic semiconductor material classification. So based on the requirement, here we go for semiconductor material, then electrode materials, insulator material, as we aware about silicon also. And for the semiconductor material, so here in depth semiconductor is discussed, small molecules and conducting polymers. So semiconductor is classified especially in two category. One is a small molecule and conducting polymer, as we aware about the silicon based inorganic material. And then a small molecule is divided in further two category, and type small molecule and p-type. In conducting also p-type conducting polymers and n-type. So here p-type especially pentacene is used, and n-type PCPB, and in p-type conducting polymer p3st, and n-type c60. C60 is the type of small molecule material and n-type conducting polymers. So these are the few examples given here along with their performance parameters. So small molecule organic semiconductor examples here, small low molecular weight, high mobility in comparison to conducting polymers. Here we given the comparison with conducting polymers, not silicon. So low mobility weight in comparison to conducting, high mobility. So that's why earlier people worked in last 3 decades based on the small molecule, very means less work is reported. So a lot of people are now working how we can develop high performance conducting polymers. And p-type materials, where p-type pentacene, tips pentacene, right, these materials. And fabrication techniques used for here, thermal evaporation and vacuum. And we are aware about what is the, this pentacene. So here we can go for group of 5 benzene rings called pentacene. Similar way, this side, these are the p-type conducting polymers. So p3st and p3at and pta. These a lot of people are worked in this, and they develop the devices based on this material. And because of a lot of work reported in pentacene because of the high mobility, yes, high mobility. So what is the merit in comparison to small molecule in conducting polymer? Only this low cost solution process techniques in comparison to this. So these are the, and this diagram is showing the P3ST. So these are the few performance parameter where we can see devices having mobility in case of dry current. So this different combination is taken by the reported here. So if we go for here, we can see this here. So these devices reported in our work. So highest mobility we get here, this for pentacene based, this pentacene. Similarly, this pentacene, hafnium oxide here. These are the other reported parameters where comparison between devices and versus mobility, then threshold voltage, all six parameters we have analyzed in this. Then this comparison of OTFT based on different materials also. So these are the different materials, and based on that we analyze the performance. So highest performance we got this mobility of this different materials. Thereafter thin film structures. So here we can see we can go for OTFT structures. So OTFT can be classified with the top gate and bottom gate. We are aware in MOSFET top gate, right? So MOSFET in top gate, whereas majority of organic electronics is used the bottom gate because of the ease in fabrication. So top gate further classify top gate, top contact, top gate, bottom contact. So here we can see gate at top, thereafter dielectric, then source and drain, then organic semiconductor. So based on the position of gate, source and drain, we can classify this different structures, right? So here in this case you can see the position of gate, source and drain and OSC. So in case of top gate, and here we can see this here contacts are over the source and drain, that's why called top contact, whereas source and drain, right, deposited before, right, thereafter OSC. So this bottom gate here we can go for bottom gate and top contact, and bottom gate, bottom contact. So this as per requirement. If somebody want okay low cost and low channel devices, then go for bottom gate, bottom contact, because in this case there is a shadow masking process used, so we can there limitation, some limitation in the channel length, but here we can utilize the photolithography process also in case of. So next is the difference between two devices. Here you can see bottom gate top contact and bottom gate bottom contact. So comparison between here this 3D structure, this 3D structure for bottom gate top contact, and the 3D structure for bottom gate bottom contact. So this circuit with the applied voltage, this. So here we can apply, so we can go for it. The performance of this high, why we have written here high mobility and low contact resistance. High mobility because here we can see the injection area this much, where in case of this injection area only this much, okay? So that's why, so high injection, high mobility, and here some deposition problem. So that's why these devices having higher contact resistance in comparison to BGTCs, okay? So if go for small channel length devices, prefer BGBC, otherwise go for this VGTC. So this, then dual gate, this is dual gate OTFT, where you can see here this dual gate device, where this top gate, then top dielectric, thereafter organic semiconductor, and these are the we compared with dual gate and single gate. So here you can see up to this place, if we go for up to this place only, so this structure is single gate, right, and additionally top top gate dielectric and top gate included in it, so dual gate. So here we can see channel formation because of the two, top gate supply and bottom gate supply, right? So dual channel. So based on this, we analyze current flow lines in the dual gate, thereafter DG operating regions. So here we can see this called different operating regions. And based on the dual gate here, what is the benefit of dual gate in comparison to single? ID is enhanced. Mobility in we got three times higher in comparison to single gate. And this threshold voltage 2.8 times lower. And transconductance 6 times higher for our devices. Then what are the different merits of single gate and dual gate based devices? So here we can see BGTC and BGBC and dual gate. So performance is high in comparison to BGBC. So fabrication using simple printing technique. This is the benefit of this. But if we compare with these two devices and this dual gate, then performance is much higher in case of dual gate. And what is the demerit? Because nothing is perfect. So that's why I also listed here. So short channel device are difficult to fabricate by using this structure. So that's why people prefer to, for the point of performance is low, right? But requirement is if we go for short channel devices, short channel length devices, then go for PGBC. Yes. And this dual gate based device implement exists during top gate deposition. So that's why. So this performance comparison between here different structures. Earlier I discussed, so here two another structure you can see. So people can work in this area also. This here we can see ditch bottom contact ditch structure as well as elevated source and drain electrode structure. So these are the two structures we have analyzed. So people can go for it, this device. So this called here D, right? BC ditch structure. Here elevated structure we have considered in our talk, this device. So I can share with this my PPT with Dr. Manoj Kumar Majumdar. Please you can collect from him. So helpful for you research, especially PhD or MTech scholars. Then impact of electrode thickness on the performance. As we aware about contact thickness impact, so charge carrier injection here. In our work earlier, lot of people worked, but they have avoided the bulk resistance. So in our one of my PhD students worked on bulk contact resistance of the channel. So this showing the how we can extract the bulk resistance of the device. So contact thickness impact the charge carrier injection, contact resistance as well as threshold. So all three analyses included in this work, and these are the mathematical model proposed. So with the help of this bent circuit or structure, people can realize the how we can extract the contact resistance and bulk resistance of the device. These are the means performance comparison given for both the devices, top contact device, this, and this bottom contact device for varying the thickness. Then different impact of the channel on the performance. So what is the means having the, so from 5 micrometer to 40 micrometer. Please don't compare, because presently lot of people are working in 8 nanometer MOSFET devices, 8 nanometer MOSFET devices, but here dimensions are larger in case of OTFT. So 5 micrometer to 40 micrometer. Recently people reported the 100 nanometer channel length OTFT device. So still a lot of people are taken up how we can optimize the performance of OTFT as well as miniaturize the size of organic material devices. That is it. So variation in the channel resistance and high biasing voltage is analyzed in this work, and the same work we have reported earlier, this channel length. So those who have interest, they can take up this work as an example. And these are the mathematical models already existing. We have applied in OTFP. Thereafter, we have compared with what is the impact of this concentration on the performance current. Then last, this effect, semiconductor and dielectric thicknesses. So here we analyze, as I discussed in my previous, bulk impact of bulk resistance. So here we can go, everyone is aware about the channel resistance, people are analyzed, right? And contact resistance, people are analyzed. In our work, we have taken this R bulk is taken up. So this important parameter we have discussed in our work. So thickness of OSE affect the electric field strength and traps in semiconductor and availability of charge carrier and bulk sheet resistance. So here this circuit diagram is given. So in this we analyze both impact of OSE as well as dielectric thickness. So and what is the thickness of affect the, so gate dielectric capacitance affect and channel formation as well as threshold voltage. As be aware that material, so this epsilon naught epsilon r over tox, so different thickness we have taken for the dielectric and analyze the impact on c is equal to epsilon naught epsilon r over tox. So if we vary this parameter, then obviously this affect the parameter of capacitance. So we have analyzed the both impact of on top contact, impact on bottom contact both. And we analyzed on this thickness of increment by 20 to 150, right? So that improves by 17% in top contact, whereas 50% in bottom, means having high impact on bottom contact devices. So these are the findings in percentage variation in parameters with variation in thickness of dielectric and thickness of OSE. So here we can go for it, this impact of OSE and impact of this. So that reduce the, especially the threshold voltage. And all four parameter we analyzed, impact on mobility, impact on threshold voltage, sub-threshold, as well as ion-off current ratio. So these are the few future research scope we have given here. So effect of interfaces, where contact semiconductor interface displays, people can take up as a research, as well as impact of this dielectric semiconductor interface. So in both the cases, so in bottom gate OTFT, dielectric surface treatment can be employed devoid of the any this impairment in organic semiconductor. Apart from that, in bottom gate bottom contact OTFT, so contacts are deposited prior to the OSE, and surface smoothing is possible. So Manoj, please, you can stop me whenever time this, no, you can, how much time is left? Yes, Manoj, please tell me the time, right? So according to that.
Yeah. No, I have already messaged you. I think you did not see it.
Okay.
So yeah, please try to finish it in 5 minutes, sir.
Oh, okay, thank you. So here we have proposed that people can analyze the impact of it, right? So this by considering both the this actually contact and semiconductor interface have also control the performance of and dielectric semiconductor also. So with this, people can apply the concept of on applying dielectric surface treatment, and trap state can be reduced substantially. Accumulation of charge at dielectric and OSE interfaces increase, and apart from that, dipole at interface also reduces self trapping of charge carriers and improve the device performance. So on applying this source and drain contact surface treatment, so charge injection and extraction can increase. Apart from that, injection barrier between contact and OSE reduces, so that have the contact resistance decreases. So this can be we can apply. Material as per the different structures people can take up. So materials here we can see this uses inclusion of modified structure. So multi-gate structure can be utilized. Yeah, I'm on just on top, right? So here the inclusion of modified structures such as multi-gate structure can be taken up, floating gate, nanowire OTFT is still none one is reported just now. So the nanowire OTFT can be taken up as in silicon based, a lot of work is the people taken up. Vertical channel, cylindrical gate, organic FinFET. So these are the area where people can take as a research from. And the analytical model for novel structure can be helpful to develop because no perfect model is available. Then multi-gate structure can be enhanced the performance of OTFT through enabling better control over the threshold voltage and improvement in the stability and lifetime. So especially these three points, stability, lifetime, and durability, and reproducibility in important challenges. So then can be taken. Thank you very much for your patience. Yes, Manoj, please.
So thank you, Professor Brijesh Kumar. Now the floor is open for the question answer session. So if the participants have any question, they may put in next 1 to 2 minutes.
Yes, please.
Okay, so I think this is so clear to all of you and all of the participants, so they don't have any question. So thank you so much, sir, for your for the valuable time, and as a token of thanks, I would like to present this memento to you.
Thank you very much. And whenever we meet, I will collect from you. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Whenever you are free, please come visit us at IIIT near IIT. Sure. So as the conference is in hybrid mode, so we will send this memento letter by post.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So. Right. So can I leave now?
Yes, sir. Please, you can leave.
Thank you.